our band that was just a wonderful. I was off dancing on the side, you couldn't see, but it was great. Thank you so much. So, hello everybody, and we're going to start the service as we start every week, lighting the flames of faith, a call to service. We perform this ceremony to promote the universal consciousness of life, which acknowledges that all peoples and all faiths, all sentient beings, come from the one great universal presence which we call spirit. Fundamental to this truth is the unifying nature of all religious thought and experience, which we honor here today. We light the candle for the Tao, honoring the universal path of harmony and equilibrium, the natural way. We light the candle for the shamanic traditions, honoring the beliefs and the practices of all indigenous peoples, the way of primal spirituality. We light the candle for Hinduism, honoring the path of knowledge, action, and devotion. We light the candle for Judaism, honoring the ethical path by living by sacred law. We light the candle for all forms of Buddhism, honoring the Four Noble Truths and the path of compassion. We light the candle for all forms of Christianity, honoring the Christ consciousness as the path of love. We light the candle for all forms of Islam, honoring the path of compliance with the will of God as the highest calling. We light the candle for the universalistic religion of Baha'i, honoring the path of unity and the path of peace. We light the candle for all forms of new thought, honoring the metaphysical path of mental healing through the practice of universal spiritual principles. And as Reverend Carla Sheradas lights the last candle, let us represent the path that brought you here this morning.
I invite you to join me in our opening affirmative prayer. There is a preciousness in the quiet. There is a connection in the presence. There is an opening in my mind recognizing that there is just one precious, perfect one that I call God. And as I open my mind and my heart and recognize that God has created all things, is all things, it has created us in its own magnificence. And as God has created everything, it has created us to create at its will. And so this morning, let us celebrate the Sabbath. A beautiful understanding of this word is a time for us, an entire day, to rest, to be in peace, to be at one with the one that has created us, to open our hearts and feel the love and the light and the joy in all the gifts that this day brings. We give thanks for this. And we give thanks for being here this morning. Thank you for the beautiful music, the melody, the lyrics, the words that are spoken. We give thanks for the success already of Reverend Judy's talk this morning, as we know that there is a new lesson to be learned on a different level with our spiritual eyes and our opening of our spiritual ears about inclusivity, about our acceptance of individuality, because that's what we were all created in. In a different idea, in a different light, all creative colors, much like a rainbow. And so let us celebrate this together. And as I move this word into an infinite law, a law that creates and says yes and does it over and over again, we know that this day is already perfect. And so it is. And won't you join me in reading on the screen the Declaration of Principles? I believe in God, the one creative intelligence operating through the universe and operating throughout my entire being, now and always. I believe this perfect spirit operates upon a law of mind and creates my experience exactly according to my belief. I believe this perfect creative intelligence can be used by me and by every other person to produce health, abundance, and love in mind, body, and total life experience. I use it now, and I rejoice in it. And so it is. And now won't you read with me our morning affirmation? I stand proud of who I am. I adore myself and give myself love freely. I bravely heal my bias and embrace all human beings and love of life with love. And so it is.
Thank you, Carla. And now Diane will do our pre-meditation song, Come Into the Silence.
Come into the silence.
we come into that silence, as we breathe in love, and as we exhale, we let our bodies relax, our shoulders drop, and we are here now in this moment, listening to Spirit. We come into the silence as we take a journey down a mountain path. As we stand at the trailhead, the cool breeze blows around our body, refreshing, exhilarating. As we walk through the forest, seeing the sun filter through the trees, the animals all around us, we are at peace. We are in nature, we are in the creation of God. It's everywhere. We travel along in peaceful contemplation of life, and we come upon a small stream across our path. The sound is delightful and refreshing. And skimming along the top of this beautiful little stream are leaves fallen from the trees. Each leaf is one of our thoughts. We have thousands every day, but we have a choice to choose which thoughts that we want to expand upon, and we let the others just float by. So we pick up the thought of kindness, we put it in our pocket. We pick up the leaf of love, and we save it for later. And all the while, all the leaves are skimming down the little stream. We can choose which ones to pick up. We pick up compassion. We pick up diversity. We pick up inclusion. We let anger, resentment, and judgment pass us by. Float on down the river. Because we are at choice. So as we sit here in the peace and the quiet of the little stream in the forest, we open our hearts, we open our minds, and we listen for the voice of Spirit. Mm-hmm. Now gently come back into the room, fully aware of this moment, alive, awake, and aware. And please welcome Chris Sheldon to the platform.
Good morning to everyone. I'm just knowing that you are all home and safe and well, and I'm happy to be here singing for you with these great musicians, knowing we can all share a wonderful message and beautiful music together, and looking forward to when we can all be together in the same room. My first song this morning is called Wild Angels, and it's by Martin Sexton.
We are wild angels.
Thank you so much, Chris. I love the concept of being a wild angel. I like that. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm so glad that you decided to join me this morning on this beautiful summer day in San Clemente. We are the Center for Spiritual Living, Capistrano Valley in San Clemente, and it is my joy to be here with you. Last week, I visualized, gave me a few moments to visualize all of you in your seats, so just give me one moment. I'm going to do that because it's pretty empty in here, so just a moment, and I can see you all. I can see you there. I see Lauren Harry. I see Gina Joyce, and yeah, there's Denise and Cheryl and my mom. I can see you all. You're all here, so thanks for being here with me. First of all, before I get started on my talk today, I want to recognize say goodbye to our dear Reverend Maddie Lang, who made her transition this week. She was a staff minister here at our center and a friend to so many people. And she just, her ministry, somebody asked me what her ministry was. It was just, she just prayed for us all. She just prayed for our kids, our grandkids, for us, our spouses, our significant others. She just knew how to pray. And so we bless her on her journey, and I'm sure she was met with open arms from Reverend Jeff. So this whole month's theme is inclusion in action. And if you remember last week, we talked about what inclusion meant, and it was the action or state of including or being included within a group or a structure, the achievement of an environment in which all individuals are treated fairly and respectfully and have equal access to the opportunities and the resources and can contribute fully to the success of all. That is inclusion. So the whole month is inclusion in action. And this week's theme is, who are we? So I'm asking you, who are you? Who are you? What are your talents? What are your gifts? How are you showing up in this journey that we call life? Oscar Wilde said, "Be yourself. Everyone else is already taken." So be unique. When I was in Science of Mind classes back in the day and learning to pray the affirmative prayer or the spiritual mind treatment, I was so envious of one of my colleagues because her prayers were so beautiful. The words used just, you know, were so gorgeous, and her prayers were so powerful. And I thought at that time, if I could pray like that, then I would be a good practitioner. So I spoke to Dr. Heather about it because I was feeling quite less than, because I was just learning and stumbling through the five steps and doing that. And Dr. Heather gave me the most valuable advice I have ever gotten. She said to me, "Judy, you are your own unique expression of the divine, and you need not imitate anyone. Who you are and the words you say are perfect." So I went, oh, do not imitate. So that's when I decided I would just have my own unique way of doing it, whatever way that was. And then I became a practitioner. Okay. So I have another one of my teachers, which was Dr. Tom Costa. He told me not to worry about speaking or being in front of people or everything, because he just said, just remember this. It's the Father within that doeth the work. So Judy, just open your mouth and Spirit will speak. So here we go. Here we go. So we must be very clear and self-observant about who we are. This is the only way that we can be inclusive and see others and what unique gifts they have to offer to the world. There is a value in getting clear about our identities, individually and collectively, and what we bring to the table. Standing in our power and celebrate our identities of other, and our identities and other identities is a gift. It also helps us to foster inclusion. Howard Thurman said this: "There is something in every one of you that waits and listens for the sound of the genuine in yourself. It is the only true guide you will ever have. And if you cannot hear it, you will all of your life spin your days on the end of the strings that someone else pulls." So we listen to our genuine self. So loving yourself is the key to loving and accepting others. Dr. Louise Hay introduced mirror work way back in the, many years ago, I think it was probably in the 90s or something like that. And it was the most effective method that I have found for learning to love myself and to see the world as a safe and loving place. Because the mirror reflects back to you the feelings you have about yourself, it makes you immediately aware of where you are resisting and where you are open and flowing. It clearly shows you what thoughts you will need to change if you want to have a more joyous and fulfilling life. So, I can remember doing the mirror work that Louise was a friend of mine for a while there, and we used to get together for about 10 or 15 years, and she gave me this card. It had mirror work on it, and the first line of it said, "I love you," and then a blank. So you're supposed to put your name in there. "I love you," and then I put Judy in there. You look in front of a mirror. You stand in front of your mirror, or you hold a handheld mirror, and you say how much you love yourself, and you do positive affirmations about the wonderful divine being that you are. It is a really powerful thing to do, but I would suggest that you do it when there's no one else around. I can remember one of the times I was standing in front of my mirror and I was saying, "Judy, I love you. You're my best friend. You're wonderful. You do dynamic things." And my grandson walked in and said, "Who in the world are you talking to?" It was quite funny. And I said, "I'm talking to myself and I'm pumping myself up and giving myself a go for the day." So it is kind of funny. I did have a friend years ago that I gave her the card, and she was having some issues with, self-esteem. So she couldn't do it. She said, "I can't do it. I'm reading this, and I can't look in my own eyes and say these words." And, you know, it takes practice. Like everything else, we have to practice loving ourselves. Because if we don't love ourselves, we cannot love others and reach out to others. We have to love ourselves. Because we must remember first and foremost that we are perfect expressions of this divine intelligence. Each of us is unique And at the same time, we are individual expressions of the whole. When we are clear about who we are, we can more fully show up and allow others to express themselves, who they are as spiritual beings. We can know God more deeply and experience inclusion in our lives when we have good self-awareness and awareness of others. There are three points that illustrate this view. The first one is that each person contains many identities, or I like to call them labels. We have millions of experiences throughout the course of our lives, and our relationship with emotions, our history, our cultural identity, our gender identity, our journey with mental health, etc., has everything to do with how we respond to different situations in our life. So it's valuable to look at these things that begin to integrate and celebrate all that we are in all these different labels and all the different identities that we have. So I'm going to tell you something. So this afternoon, when you are sitting around the house or sitting at the beach, start writing down all your labels. It's amazing how many there are. It's just amazing. I started writing mine down, so I got just down a few. I'm a daughter, a mother, a sister, a Grammy, an aunt, a cousin. I'm a manager, chief financial officer, teacher, practitioner, minister, a friend, and then in my past, I was a singer and a guitar player in a bar, and I was also a dancer and a party animal. But those were in the past. We all have identities that we've let go of when they did no longer serve us in our present moment. So of course, the list goes on and on. We have so many different aspects to our personality. And so, but those were only my human labels. We have spiritual labels because we are spiritual beings, and we are, all those labels are the qualities of God. For all the qualities of God are who we are and what we express. So we need to be gentle with ourselves when discovering what parts of ourselves we may have been repressing, and also be claiming and healing our unique journeys and our identities. It's very, sorry. It's very powerful when we claim our own identities and our gifts, because we are the beloved and we are a blessing to the world now and forever. Jalaluddin Rumi, the 13th century Sufi poet, says this: "Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving, it doesn't matter. Ours is not a caravan of despair. Come, even if you have broken your vows 1,000 times, come yet again. Come, come." So after we have identified who we are in the first point, we can now move to the second point, which is seeing ourselves more clearly. Sometimes that's hard to look at. I think that this point should have a warning sign on it, because those of us that have been in classes, practitioner class, science mind classes, seminars, retreats, anything that digs down deep, we know that it is sometimes painful for these hidden parts of us to come to the surface. When these deeply buried emotions come up and to the light of truth, a healing does occur. It can be painful in that healing. I think of it like a butterfly that is coming out of the cocoon and has to squeeze out of there so that the fluids will go into its wings so it can fly. But it's got to be a hard birth. You know what I'm saying? So sometimes when we're getting our stuff out of the way, it is painful, and it's sometimes very emotional. So that healing started with me when I was in practitioner class. I did a lot of digging and lots of healing during that time. When we see ourselves more clearly, we can then celebrate who we are. It often becomes easier to begin with, and we might pick up on some subconscious biases or some false beliefs that need to be healed and removed, and we didn't even know that they were there. So with the help of trusted friends, colleagues, teachers, family members, practitioners, ministers and teachers, and therapists, we can uncover these biases and false beliefs and bring them to the light. Because of how our brains work, our biases are sometimes apparent to us, but they are often hidden. And what we call our subconscious biases, or the collective consciousness, or I've heard it called the race consciousness. So when we begin to ask ourselves the good questions about what we believe and where do these beliefs and these thoughts come from, then we're taking the important step towards healing these subconscious biases and seeing ourselves more clearly. The third point is knowing that awareness is a tool. Self-awareness is an extraordinary tool in putting inclusion in action. Because when we become self-aware, there is a much greater opportunity for healing and healing our genuine truth and claiming our beauty and our power. But most of all, we become aware of those subconscious biases that we didn't even know we had. So healing cannot happen without honest inquiry into the self. I think we need to hear that one again. Healing cannot happen without honest inquiry into the self. When we're willing to do this, it is an important step in building the practice of being aware of others and ultimately loving people for exactly who they are. Thich Nhat Hanh said that if we don't embrace and look deeply, we drown in the ocean of our suffering. We must look deeply. Discovering who we are and we really are is an exciting and somewhat challenging journey. There is also some fear involved at the start. Back in the 90s, early 90s, Dr. Marcia Sutton started a retreat called Sacred Days. And there was sacred days of co-creation, sacred days of my life purpose, sacred days of Jesus the teacher. There was several different ones. And I attended over the period of about 10 years, seven of those retreats. And they were 5 days long. And I remember the first time I went, they were up in Oregon. It was beautiful there. I just wanted to go up there and experience the old forest in Oregon. It was great. But the first night after we arrived, she started talking about what we were going to be doing for that week. And I got scared. I really didn't want to dig that deep. It was, I didn't want to go there. It was things that were buried. They were buried and they needed to stay where they were. So I went to her after the evening talk and I said, you know, I think I'm just going to go home and I'll just be safe there. And she said, Judy, you need to stay. You will grow and you will expand and you will get those things out and it will be released. So I went and I stayed and I went back 6 or 7 times over the years. I had a lot of self-incrimination, self-shame, judgment to release. And finally, I think it was after about 9 or 10 years, I finally got out. So we need to look, we need to dig. It was an easy thing to do. It was painful. But it was worth it because my relationship with my people I love, my family and my friends, benefited from it. And I benefited because I could move forward on my spiritual path and I couldn't have everything still been buried. So I evolved and I expanded and I grew in consciousness. At the time I found out some old beliefs and old hidden things that I really didn't know I had. And I was so glad that they came up and came to the light of truth. And once it's exposed, then it can dissipate and it can be released. But I was with people I trusted, and that's important. So you get to find someone you trust, someone who loves you, practitioner, a minister, or a teacher, someone. So I have continued over the years to take any and all opportunities for growth because it's important that we don't just stop. We just continue to grow and learn and expand. And that includes, I've taken more classes, more Science of Mind classes. We do gatherings and circles with like-minded people. Retreats, not so much anymore. So unfortunately, I was signed up for one, the Circle of Love retreat in Lucerne Valley in March and had to cancel that. I can't wait till we can get back together again and do this for seminars. So in the meantime, it's readings and listening to inspirational subjects and listening to all the different people that are on Facebook that we can listen to all their talks on Sunday morning talks, and people have meditations and music. It's just wonderful. We have a plethora of information available to us. Another quote from Rumi. He says, beyond ideas of wrongdoing and rightdoing, there is a field. I'll meet you there. When the soul lies down in that grass, the world is too full to talk about. Ideas, languages, even the phrase each other doesn't make any sense. So in conclusion, let's bravely explore our identities. in all their complexity and their splendor. Let's look at what is asking for some healing in our lives. Let's kindly and boldly explore our subconscious biases. The work of coming to know and love the self, and the work of coming to be able to actually see other people and love them for who they are, that is divine work. It is the work of seeing, knowing, and loving God more deeply. It is the act of being awake to the truth of the universe. And so it is. Thank you. And now we'll pray. We join together once again in the serenity of prayer, recognizing the power and the presence of Almighty God, recognizing that this essence is the first cause to all of creation, that it is unconditional love, it is awesome magnificence, it is the breath, it is the life, it is the joy of each one of us. This energy and this vitality is everywhere present at all times. Therefore, it lives and moves and has its expression through each one of us. We are the expression of the beloved. We are the compassion. We are the voice. We are the action. We are the breath of life. So this morning I affirm and I decree that all is well. That each one of us is awake, alive, and aware of this essence, this presence, this divinity within us. And we love it. And as we love God, we love ourselves because we are the expression of God. And when we love ourselves so much, then we can take that love and give it out. We can love others. We can see others. We can recognize others. And we can live in this moment. So we are inclusive. We are divine. So I place these words into that divine mind, knowing that they've already been created exactly as they've been spoken. All is well. All are safe. All are loved. And so my heart is full of gratitude and so much thanksgiving for this time together, for this teaching, for this knowing, for this love that expands and grows within each one of us. And so I anchor this prayer in joy. I anchor this prayer in love. As we say together, and so it is. Amen. And now, Chris Sheldon.
This song is called Singing for Our Lives. It's a Holly Near song. But I think before that, even, it's an older hymn that Holly wrote some lyrics, different lyrics for.
Mm-hmm.
Take your gift in your hand, and there is a phone number to text for your contribution. You know that our center is solely run on your gifts and your contributions to us, and you can also mail in a check, which would be fine. But let's take our gift and hold it in our hand and really feel our affirmation. My offering is my acceptance of God as the source of my supply, and it symbolizes my faith in the abundant flow of this supply. Thank you.
And now we're going to do our closing song. So please join us from home, or as Reverend Judy said, the beach, or wherever you may be, on the peace song.
us for coffee and conversation on Zoom, and then Conscious Connection at 12 o'clock. Thank you all for being here, and have a lovely week.